good to see you today. Wow, what a beautiful, this might be the last really warm day we have of the season, right? Because I think here in just a couple days, we're going to dip down into the 50s during the day. I don't know, some of you like that weather. How many like that cooler weather? Oh, wow, look at this. You can tell you Pittsburghers, right? How many like the really warm Florida weather? Okay, yeah, all right. Well, welcome everyone. It's so good to see you today. And we're going to do something a little different because we're having a little bit of audio trouble up there here this morning. So we're going to ask you to go ahead and pull out your hymnals, okay? The Blue Book. The Blue Book. What do you think about that, huh? The Blue Book. And we're going to sing an old, old hymn of the church, and I know that the folks online are not going to see the words, but you know most of these words anyways, and it's, "Oh, how I love Jesus." Don't you love Jesus today? How many love Jesus? Say amen. 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 And so, Lord, we do love you, and we worship you today, and we pray that you'll be honored by everything that is said and done that'll bring glory to the name of Jesus, because you are worthy. You are worthy today, Jesus, to be worshiped and to be praised, and we give you that glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together. 137. Did I not tell you the page?
I wasn't paying
attention.
Did
I not tell you the page? Well, you know what you can do if I don't tell you that? Look in the back of the hymnal. Okay. Oh, how I love Jesus. 137. 137. Okay. That's it. Amen. Ready?
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Oh, you sound great.
It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea.
Amen.
Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me what my Father hath in store for every day. And though I tread a darksome path, yield sunshine all the way. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Oh, don't you love him today? Just say, "I love you, Jesus." That's it. Just worship him. Just take time. Let's worship him, Jesus. Is there someone? You may be seated. Is there someone who would like to give a word of testimony this morning? Let me have a mic here. Can I use your mic, brother? Anybody want to offer up a word of praise? Praise to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah. I just want to thank the Lord for what he's been doing in my life. I mean, I sold my house the same day I put it up. Everything's going well. I thought I was getting a new job, but my new job, the people owning the store called me personally and asked what they could do to prove my work job. So God has, and I have prayed for a long time that he would help me figure out what to do, because it's hard living by yourself when you restore it up. But God is awesome.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. God is, yeah. Let's just turn this red up just a little bit there, brother. Amen. Amen.
Well, you know, Pastor Joseph is always encouraging us to be in the Word, in the Word, in the Word. And this week when I was in the Word, I just felt like something just jumped off the page at me, and I felt like it was something I wanted to share with all of you, because it's something so many of us are praying about our prodigals. And it's from Isaiah 49. Verses 8, 22, and 25. It says, look around you and see, for all your children will come back to you.
Amen.
As surely as I live, says the Lord, they will be like jewels or bridal ornaments for you to display. This is what the sovereign Lord says. See, I will give a signal to the godless nations. They will carry your little sons back to you in their arms.
Ooh, yeah.
They will bring your daughters on their shoulders.
Yeah.
Finally, but the Lord says, the captives of warriors will be released, and the plunder of tyrants will be retrieved, and I will fight those who fight you, and I will save your children.
Amen. Hey, everybody say amen. I receive that word. Isn't that a powerful word? Those prodigals, God, amen. Hallelujah. What's that scripture again so they can write that down, Meredith? What is that scripture?
That is Isaiah 49, verses 8, 22, and 25.
Okay. Amen. Amen. Good. Anybody? I think we still might need this up just a bit there, Dave. There we go. Thank you, buddy. Anybody else? A word. A word of praise. Anybody? Joel, brother Joel. Well, Joel, you can just stand there, brother.
It's the testimony that I wanted to say. So that the church will listen to what the Lord is working miraculously in our lives. Last Sunday, the Noyes family did not come to church. Mm. Almost like 2 weeks, and my heart was troubled. I was looking for them. I don't know what happened. My heart was really, really broken. I was thinking about them, and I was praying for them. When I went to get-go to put gas in the car, I called Rebecca, and I was talking to Rebecca, and when I heard Rebecca's voice, it was like a spark of light in my head, in my body.
Amen.
And I was talking to her. I was holding my phone on my right hand, and I pulled out my wallet from my pocket, and I was filling the gas. I pulled out my debit card, and I put in, and I was filling in. I put my wallet on the top of the vehicle, and I was talking. So when I was talking, I know. So when I was talking, I left my wallet on the top of my vehicle, and I went back to my car. I started driving. I went to the car wash. So I went to the car wash. My wallet was on the top of the car. And you know what happened? It was washed away. It was washed away, and the wallet has everything, including my everything. It has everything.
It has everything.
So when I went home, I now wanted to change the clothes, and normally I can feel it, but now it is not there. I said, now where is it? Let me go back to the car and find out in the car. It wasn't there. And I said, okay, let me go back to get-go. I drove back to get-go, and I went straight to the cashier, and I said, did you guys find any wallet? Somebody found any wallet, by chance? And somebody said, you are the most blessed person in this planet. Somebody got your wallet in the car wash place, and he picked it up, and he brought it to me. It is wet, but there is nothing lost. And I have to praise the Lord because I was concerned. I was caring about my people. I was caring about my family. And the Lord knew how much my love was for my family. And the Lord was able to get me out of that where I would be in trouble forever. I have to praise the Lord for that. Praise his name.
Powerful?
It is.
Hallelujah. What a word.
It is.
Anybody else? Anybody else? A word of praise. How much you love Jesus. Amen.
I had an opportunity yesterday speaking with a missionary from this church with the Christ in Action group, and she was doing an assessment of one of the people's places, and she didn't know that she was standing on a red ant hill.
Yeah, fire ant, yeah.
And so she got all bit up, and me and her and Carol went into prayer, and the Lord healed her.
Amen.
There was not even a mark on her leg, and she's praising the Lord over there.
Amen. Anybody from the South knows about fire ants, right? Oh, my goodness. They're bad news.
Praise the Lord, church.
Amen.
Yeah, that was last weekend. Yeah, it was the international service on Saturday. And then that week I was supposed to be working. And then the whole week I was like, Pastor Joe called me in the middle of the week. And then he said, I know you'll not be here for the service on Saturday. Because I wanted some stuff to be done for the service. This keep bothering me. I will not be there because I'll be at work. Because I work second shift from 3 to 11.
Right.
And the service start at 4.
Right.
Then I talked to God. I said, God, you know how I don't miss services like that. I don't want to miss that service. How can I? And if I tell my people at work, they will say, weekends they don't give you off.
Yeah.
Because they know people are not there. Then on Thursday morning, because Joel called me on Wednesday evening, then I told him that I'm not going to make it. But let's see what God is going to do. Thursday morning, the morning, I just wake up around 10, 9, and then my supervisor called me. Gloria, do you need a day off? I said, hallelujah, praise the Lord. So she told me, okay, Saturday. I thought maybe she's going to tell me Thursday, don't come. But she told me Saturday, the 19th. I say, oh, praise the living God. I will not miss that service.
Amen.
Then again, she said, okay, Gloria, you still have some PTOs here. Why can't you make it also Saturday, Sunday? I say, oh my God. I'll praise you forever. Hallelujah.
Amen. That's good. That's good. Oh, I'll tell you, God is good, isn't he? All the time, right?
God is good.
Oh, God is good. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus.
Oh, how I love Jesus.
Together, church, one more beautiful song, Knowing You, Knowing You. All I once held dear, this whole world, take it all, but give me Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Oh, how I love you.
World of reveals and roars to
Church, you may be seated. Thank you, Jesus.
You, God, are my God. Eternally I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being is longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary and behold your power and your glory, because your love is better than life. My lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. And in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the riches of the foods. With the singing lips, my mouth will praise you. Yes. Oh, my Lord, even on my bed, I remember you. Mm-hmm. I think of you through the watches of the night, because you are my help. I sing with the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your right hand upholds me. Establish us, O Lord, for your kingdom. O God, our Lord, you reign from the everlasting to everlasting. You are mighty. Your glory is eternal. Holy Lord, we understand that it's only those that are clean hands and pure hearts that can tarry in your glory. God of heaven, clean us all of our iniquities. Amen. Make us holy in your presence, O God. Help us to enjoy all the blessings that comes with your worship that is established in the blood that is being purchased for our cost. We thank you, God, for the mystery of your word. And we thank you for your presence that you are going to manifest in our lives now and forever. We worship your name and we glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. One day, as Jesus was teaching, some men came carrying a paralytic on a mat. They tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven. Get up, take your mat, and go home." Immediately, the paralytic stood up in front of them. He took what he had been lying on and went home praising God. Aren't you glad for the day? You remember the day when Jesus said to you, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." You remember that day? Amen. Let's stand together. He took my sins away.
I came to Jesus weary, worn, and sad. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And now his love has made my heart so glad. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took sins away. The load of sin was more than I could bear. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And now on him I roll my every care. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keeps me singing every day. I'm so He took my sins away. He took my sins away. No condemnation have I in my heart. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. His perfect peace he did to me impart. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. He took my sins away. And keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away. He took my sins away. If you will come to Jesus Christ today, he'll take your sins away. He'll take your sins away. And keep you happy in his love each day. He'll take your sins away. He took my sins away, he took my sins away, and keeps me singing every day. I'm so glad he took my sins away, he took my sins away.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated, church. There are a lot of needs in our midst this morning, and as we go to the Lord in prayer here today, I want to encourage you just to know that he is more than able to handle anything that concerns you this day. A number of our people are sick, one thing or another. Denise isn't feeling very well today, and neither is Gina. We want to lift them up to the Lord in prayer. We want to lift up Carol Roserill's family. As you know, her son-in-law passed away suddenly this week. 59 years old, heart attack, massive heart attack, and the funeral is this afternoon, and so be praying for us as we have that service at 3:30 this afternoon, and that there will be salt and light in that dark place, okay? And that those who do not know Jesus will have the chance to receive him as their Savior, right? Because there is going to come a time when all of us must face that day, and we need to know where we are going to spend eternity, amen? So I want to encourage you to be praying for me. As I minister there to the family, I thank God that I have the privilege. You know, I never mind doing this because these people may be the only time that I ever see them, and this may be the only time that they will ever hear the truth of the gospel. And this will be their opportunity to receive the word and receive it gladly in their hearts. Amen? Right? Thank the Lord. Amen. So, but also, let's be praying for comfort for Carol. Nikki, her daughter, and the family, the loss here. You never expect these things, do you? We never know what to expect in our lives. Want to thank God for successful, I want to say it that way, I guess, a successful march there, a prayer walk there in D.C. with Franklin Graham and his ministry yesterday, praying at different points along the mall there, seeking God for our nation. Want to thank God for Rabbi, Messianic Rabbi Jonathan Kahn and his ministry there in the return, calling the people of America back to repent and return to God, the God of our fathers. They are asking us to make this Sunday a Sunday of repentance. So the songs we've been singing, you know, he took my sins away, he took my sins away, knowing that he can do that, but we must receive it by acknowledging that we are sinners. We must confess our sins before him. I preached last Sunday about the plan of salvation. I want to kind of continue that this morning, and I will be giving another altar call this morning, all right? And to give you opportunity that if you have not received the grace of God in your life, today is the day to receive it, okay? But we need to cry out, as Daniel cried out, for his people, his nation. The people of Israel spent 70 years in captivity. Let me tell you, church, I don't want to spend 70 years in captivity. I want to call upon God now. And I want to repent of the sins of this American people now. And I want to see God move now and call us back to him. In this day of upheaval, of rioting, of pandemics and deceit and deception and false narratives and all the stuff that's out there, shutting down churches and all this stuff. Let me tell you, today is the day for us to cry out like never before. Because as Meredith said, she keeps thinking over and over and over. I keep saying, the answer is not in the White House. The answer is not in the courthouse. The answer is not in the state house. The answer is in God's house. The answer, because we have the hope. Because Christ in us is the hope of glory. The only hope for this nation is Christ in us as we are out there proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? And those of you who have come from other nations and you have seen what war has done and you see what those false narratives do and you see what happens and the oppression and the persecution, I do not want that to happen to our nation. I want to see our nation turn back to Almighty God. So I want to encourage you today as we cry out. So this morning during our prayer time, you may have personal things, but I'm going to ask you to come and gather on the altar. And if you, let's just cry out for repentance for our nation. We are Americans, and there's a lot of sin. There's a lot of sin in America that we got to repent of. We got to repent of. We got to repent of killing our unborn children. We got to repent for forgetting about our elderly and shutting them up in homes and turning our backs on them. We got to repent of that. We got to repent that we kicked God out of our schools and out of our courtrooms. We got to repent of that. We got to repent that we kicked God out of our marketplaces. We got to repent that we kicked God out of our homes. And most of all, we got to repent that we kicked God out of our churches. Out of our churches. And we said we don't need the word of God. We got to repent. So I'm going to ask you, let's make this day a day of repentance. And let's cry out. If you want to be anointed for any reason, let's reserve the front pew for anointing. But those who want to cry out for our nation, I'm just encourage you to come here this morning as we seek God today. But aren't you glad kings and kingdoms may pass away, but there's something about that glorious name of Jesus.
Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus. Jesus, let all heaven just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain. Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something
Jesus, 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 your name is above all the names. All the kingdoms of this earth will all come and bow down before you, the throne of your glory. Almighty God, we worship you and we give you honor and glory for the opportunity that you have given us today, that we can have this chance to come and bow down, yes, and hear your voice speaking to us in a silent and beautiful sound. Father, we come personally before you. We personally, individually, we want to bring all ourselves, yes, before you, the throne of your glory. That, Lord, you will clean us.
Yes.
You will clean us.
Yes, clean us, Jesus.
You will sweep all corners of our lives.
Amen, amen.
That we will be clean and pure. That you can use us for your kingdom. That you will manifest the Holy Spirit in us.
Yes, Jesus.
That you will pour your Holy Spirit right now in our midst. And fill us that we will dwell with your Son. Oh God, make us your sons and daughters to glorify your name in this country, in our families, in our neighborhood, individually. Lord, make us your own children, loved children. Make all men and women to come and confess to you and to repent to you individually of their own life.
That's it, Jesus.
Because when you come, you are not going to take me with my wife or with my child or with my father or my mother. You are going to take me alone.
Alone, yes.
So the salvation is alone.
That's it.
It is for myself. Lord, clean my heart. Clean each and every one heart tonight, that we all come before you. Lord, we cry as a church.
Yes, we do.
We pray that your will be done on earth, across all, yes, the globe.
Yes.
That God, your word, will be preached to the corners of the world that have never heard you.
Yes.
And we pray for those who are dying for the salvation, that, Lord, you may rescue them.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, you may shine your face to them. Some of them have been persecuted because they are holding your holy word.
That's right.
Lord, watch over them. We pray for the entire church, the church that you have bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We pray for the pastors and all the leaders, yes, across the world, that we will be one church.
That's it, one church.
Jesus. Only one church.
One church.
United in you.
Yes, Lord.
With one voice. We pray for all the church in this country. Lord, we thank you that there are some men and women who are so bold that they are coming up even regardless of whatever is going on, still they are coming up to proclaim your word in this country.
Yes,
Lord, plant your word to grow like a mustard seed in the lives of our lives. Lord, we pray for the leaders, particularly the leaders of United States of America.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Lord, it's almost coming time of election.
Yes, Jesus.
Father, we pray that you put the right ballot in our hand.
Amen.
To vote to a right person.
Yes.
That will lead this country to the right position.
Amen. Yes. Yes.
To glorify your name. You have given us the authority as a church to speak boldly. We are talking to each other so that, Lord, you may teach us your right way. Father, we pray for those who are weak, that they could not be able to make here due to some reasons, whether being health issues or social problems. Father, we lift up the family of Sister Carol, who have lost that young, energetic gentleman.
Yes, Jesus.
That we have lost as a community. We have lost as a people. We have lost as a family. But you have gained. Because you have taken him to where there is no sorrow. Where there is no pain. Where there is no drooping. Where there is no pine. No wonder what else where to be. Father, consult the family. I know Carol has been going through a lot of difficulties.
Yes, she has.
But Lord, you have never let her alone. She's still limping and walking in you.
Amen.
And we are so thankful to see women and men of God who are there, regardless of the pain they are bearing.
That's right.
Still they come before you to worship you.
Yes, Jesus.
We thank you. Father, we lift up Gina. She's not been able to come today because of some reasons, health issues. Lord, watch over her. Hold her in your hand. Wrap her with your everlasting arms. Father, we pray for Denise. We know how much she loves you. And I know she is even worshiping you wherever she is right now. Father, we thank you that you will be visiting her. As a visitor, you know the meaning of visitor. When somebody comes in, he comes in to sit in the clean place. Sit in her heart.
That's right.
Sit in her spirit.
Yes.
That, Lord, you may renew her. You may make her holy.
Mm-hmm.
Father, thank you. There are needs in our community, some of them that I am not being able to mention because there are so many that I could not even mention all of them. God, may your Holy Spirit continue to be with us. We thank you for the ministries that you have given us all here.
Yeah.
Father, we pray for these people who have come before your throne. You know their needs one by one. May you answer their prayer. May you hold them. May you show your face unto them. Lord, I cannot pray like each and everyone knows how to pray. But you put the words in my mouth to speak to you and to lift up the supplication of these people right now who have bowed down. Not only that they are respecting me, but they are respecting you in heaven.
Yes.
Because you are our God. Father, we thank you. May your Holy Spirit continue to lead us in this service. May your Holy Spirit be with Pastor Joe as he brings the word to us.
Yes.
May your Holy Spirit be with the choir. May your Holy Spirit be with our children.
Yes.
May your Holy Spirit be with everyone in this house. Bless us, Father, because you are worthy and holy to be magnified and to be glorified.
Yes.
We worship you. We ask all this through Christ our Lord. Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
We thank you. And those who I can ask the intercessors, please come forward to bless the people that have come for prayer.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King. Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all nations. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him. Love and adore Him. His name is wonderful. Jesus. Sing it. Something Jesus, Yeshua, Adonai, Messiah, Lord, we worship you today. Amen. Praise his name.
This is the difficult time. I think everybody is checking his pockets right now. It is time of giving. So,
amen.
We know that we worship with the music.
Yes.
We worship with the word of God.
Yes.
We worship with singing. And we also worship with the giving.
Amen, we do.
And it says very clear that blessed are those who give than receive. So it is time for us to give. Check your pockets and check your purses right now.
Amen. Amen. Yes.
Therefore, do not cast away your confidence,
That's right.
Which has great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise.
That's it.
Hebrews 10:35-36. Yes. May I ask the ushers please to come forward and to give the offertory.
Thank you for that fine offering. Thank you for your continued faithfulness in your giving of your tithes and offerings. Amen. A few announcements I'd like to make here this morning, and that is, first of all, before I forget, this Thursday at 2 o'clock will be the interment service for Jess Sellers at Jefferson Memorial. And so if you are interested in attending that, you are welcome to do so. It will be a fairly brief service. It will not be a full-fledged funeral-type service, but it will be an interment service, scripture, a few words. But you are certainly invited at 2 o'clock if you're able and not working to attend that at Jefferson Cemetery. We will be at the grave site. So if you go in and you make the first turn to the right, go down the hill and it's at the bottom, okay? And so that's where it'll be. Also, we actually had failed to have our 40 Days for Life sign-up sheet for prayer and fasting. We started this past week, Thursday, and we want to thank God, first of all, that Thursday was not an abortion day and that there were no babies aborted on Thursday when we were down there. We also want to thank God that there was no, difficulties by way of rioting or protesting or anything of that sort, because they are anticipating leading up to the election that there may be increased violence at 40 Days for Life vigils. So this is why we really need you to be praying as well, okay? So I'm going to ask Meredith. This is our sign-up sheet here. And what we've done this time, I think it's a lot better plan, Meredith. Just take a day, okay? And you may fast, you may pray during that time. One meal, any meal, every meal. You may fast Facebook, which might be may not be a bad idea these days, fasting Facebook, okay? And a few other things. So, and then we also have another petition that we passed around on Wednesday, and I'm going to give this to Meredith as well. It's already on the back. This is in regards to Allegheny County. This is a petition to our county council that they would support our First Amendment right for freedom of religion and freedom of speech. They want to take down all signage on Port Authority buses and bus stops and so forth for right to life, okay? So we want to ask them to honor our First Amendment right for freedom of speech and freedom of religion. So if you live in Allegheny County, we just need your name, your signature, print, and your municipality and your address. If you would do that, we will give that to the right people, okay? So those things are very, very important. This is part of our Brave that we are participating in, that we're trying to get these things to you ahead of time so that we're not caught off guard or too late to do something about it. You may also call or email all of the county council members. If you go to the Allegheny County website, all you got to do is fill it in, and it goes to all of them. Let me tell you, they do read them. They do read them. Don't think that they don't read them, because they do. And they really, really, really appreciate your input, and especially when you tell them you appreciate them, you're praying for them, and so forth, okay? So this is a time for us to do that. Also, take your bulletins, and please note the next Sunday is our Mission Sunday. Again, we're going to be having our dinner afterwards, and we had a great time last month, and it'll be a good time as well. Next Sunday, plan to enjoy some international food, but there's also regular food and a great study about what God is doing around the world in building his kingdom. Also, on October 1st, I know some of you guys are not in school, actually. Some of you are in school. So if you are in school, October 1st is the day that we encourage you to take your Bibles. Take your Bibles. Don't be ashamed of the Word of God. Jesus said that if you're ashamed of me, then I'll be ashamed of you before my Father on the day of judgment. So I want to encourage you, please take your Bibles. Let everyone know that you're a Christian. And take that as an opportunity to be salt and light in your schools. If you would like to take some of the little booklets to hand out, we have lots of little booklets that tell people how to become a Christian. We have plenty of those. So October 1st, we're encouraging our students, all of our students, to do that. Joel, you see your pew over there is getting full of clothing and things like that for our containers, okay? So we are collecting clothing, also things, staples like table salt, washing soap, and things of that sort. So if you have any questions, please see Joel about that, and we are collecting that. He's also needing volunteers. Our ESL program is expanding. Lots and lots of students. The only change here in this is it is actually Thursdays and Fridays, not Tuesdays and Thursdays. If you're available Thursdays and Fridays, please see Joel, and he will give you those details. This Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock is our second service, the Church at McGee. Those of you who have those Church at McGee, stand up, Brother Chuck, and turn around and show them how beautiful those are. Look at those. the Church and McGee. And these are great t-shirts. If you'd like to order one, please see Meredith. Frank has them back there. Meredith, I saw a couple. I saw a couple others. 4 o'clock down at Zulima Parklet, right there, right across, basically from McGee Women's Hospital. First service was tremendous. We're just coming against by worshiping Almighty God. That's what we're doing. We're worshiping is what we're doing. Okay. Now I will not be there today because of the funeral service. Otherwise, we would be there. Our Messianic congregations will be there, and they will be hosting that worship service. So if you're able to go, there's plenty of parking there. Sunday afternoon, plenty of parking all along the street and so forth. So I encourage you to do that. Brother Rick will be there. He'll direct you. He'll show you where to park across the street, protect you as you're going across, right? Okay, you did a great job last time, and so we appreciate that. So I encourage you to be there if at all possible. And the other information that is there for you, Bible reading and so forth, just encourage you to keep that before the Lord in prayer. I'd like for us to continue basically what I started last week. I want to flesh out a little bit more about the way of salvation that God has planned for us. And I would like to talk about the fact that really, the way of salvation is a way back to holiness. It's a way back to holiness. Holiness is a right relationship with God. When you are in a righteous relationship with Him, okay, then you are in a holy relationship with God. There are a couple scriptures I'd like for you to turn to this morning, if you would. Turn to John 7:38. John 7:38. And 1 Peter 1. Verses 15 and 16. Because we need to have a restoration of harmony in our relationship with God. As I spelled out for you last week, God created us holy. Can you imagine walking holy before God in a face-to-face relationship with Him in the Garden of Eden? Can you imagine that, daily experiencing that? Then sin entered the picture. Sin broke our relationship with God. And so began a process of restoring that relationship throughout the rest of human history, leading up to the cross of Jesus Christ. It is a way to bring us back to the way of salvation, the way of holiness, the way that we need to walk in so that we can have a relationship that is in harmony with who God is. The first scripture is John 7:38. Jesus said, whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. The scriptures he's talking about were the Old Testament scriptures. The Old Testament. He says, the scriptures testified of me. That if you believe in him, the Old Testament, he says, the Old Testament is saying, if you believe in Jesus, you will have eternal life, and out of your very being will flow rivers of living water. You think he's talking about the New Testament. He's not. It wasn't even written then. He's talking about the Old Testament. You see how important it is to study and read the Old Testament. It testifies about who Jesus is, because God always had a plan of restoration, of harmony in our relationship with Him. The second scripture is this. What is that plan? That plan is found in 1 Peter 1:15 to 16. Peter is quoting the book of Leviticus. You say, can anything good come out of the book of Leviticus? Okay. Every time I get through, I think, oh Lord, do I have to read Leviticus one more time in my yearly Bible reading? All the sacrifices and this number of bulls and this number of lambs and putting the blood on the right big toe and the right index. I mean, you know, it's like, oh, do I have to read that one more time? And God says, yes, it's my word. And there's life in my word. Right in the very middle of Leviticus, you have what it's all about. What Leviticus is all about is the fact that God is a holy God. And God demands holiness from a people that he wants to be in relationship with. And so Peter says, quoting the book of Leviticus, just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written in the book of Leviticus, be holy because I am holy. Do you think that God would give you a command that he could not, by the power of his Holy Spirit, fulfill in you? God says he wants you to be holy. And he will give you his Spirit to make that possible. Aren't you glad today? You can be holy before God. Holiness brings us in harmony with God in our relationship with him. You see, God had a plan from the beginning, as I shared last week. God revealed his plan before he actually ever created man. Ephesians 1:4 says, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be what? Holy and blameless in his sight. What did God want for us before he ever created us? To be holy and to be blameless. He did that before the world was ever created, before he ever created us. It is clear that God created mankind because he wanted to enjoy fellowship with him. And to have that kind of relationship, there would have to exist harmony between God and man, right? They would have to share values. They would have to share values and interests. And 1 Peter 1:15 says that after giving the command to be holy, he hastens to say, he gives the reason, because it is the fact that God himself is a holy God. God is holy, and he wants us to be holy. What is holiness? Holiness is being in a right relationship with God. It's being in that righteousness that he gives to us. My friends, God wants us to share his same nature. He created us in his image. He wants us to share his nature. He wants us to be like him. Let me tell you, we were not created to argue with God. Okay, that deserves taking off the jacket. We were not created to argue with God, right? We were not created to be in conflict with God. We were what? He desired to have fellowship with us. Based on a unity of spirit and purpose at the very deepest levels of our being. My friends, there is no place for animosity in our relationship with Almighty God. According to God's plan, it is to be a relationship of mutual love. Don't you want to be in love with God? Why? Because God is in love with you. We only love God because he first loved us. He's in love with us. He wants us to be in love with him. And so because of that, harmony is to be desired. And isn't harmony a beautiful thing? Isn't harmony a beautiful thing? We recognize it when it comes to music, because you know when we sing off key, don't you? You know when I play the wrong notes on the piano, don't you? Say, oh boy, I remember we had a visiting evangelist. You know what story I'm going to talk about. We had a visiting evangelist, and we had one of our associate pastor's wives. She wasn't a great piano player. She could play, but she had a little trouble, okay? And she couldn't get all of the notes just right. So right in the middle of one of the songs we were singing, the evangelist looks over and he says her name. He says, it's an F sharp. It's an F sharp. She says, I know it's an F sharp, I just can't play it. My friends, harmony is a beautiful thing. You know it when you listen to an orchestra, a symphony orchestra, and when it's all in tune, it thrills our ears, doesn't it? When you listen to a symphony, I can tell you this, it happens because it is planned that way. The composer chooses the musical key. Then he writes the part for each instrument so that they blend together in an ear-pleasing harmony. And when the orchestra comes together to perform the work of art, they begin by asking a single instrument to sound a keynote. Then every other instrument adjusts its tone to be in agreement with that sound. You've been there, haven't you? You sit there, and what's the first thing? They all come out, and all of a sudden you hear the first instrument, and then you think, what in the world? And they're all getting in tune to that one instrument. Every instrument adjusts. The violins adjust by loosening or tightening their strings. The horns match the tone by shortening or lengthening the tubes that the air passes through. And the process continues until every instrument is in tune. That, my friends, eliminates sour notes. And the result is magnificent. You listen to that and you think, you almost think you're in heaven. When you hear that beautiful music, you sit there and it just takes you to a different place, doesn't it? Fills up that whole auditorium. And you think, oh my goodness. How many of you have experienced what I'm talking about? It's beautiful. It's powerful, isn't it? It's moving. It's so moving. Well, when harmony does not exist, it can be pretty painful. You see, it's the major difference between music and noise. A difference between symphony and what they call cacophony. Symphony, everything in harmony. Cacophony, everything out of tune. It's just noise. You see, disharmony, whether in a symphony or in a relationship, it represents conflict, disagreement, incompatibility, clashing, discord, disorder, antagonism, stress, opposition. Do any of those things sound familiar to you? But harmony represents the opposite: agreement, compatibility, accord, good relationship, and the absence of conflict. My friends, the reason God created the human race was that he desired fellowship in harmony with beings like himself. He designed man with the possibility before he ever created him that we should be holy. Turn, if you will, to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. Let's take a look and see what Paul says here. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. When did he choose us? Before we were ever created. Before God ever created us, he chose us. He chose us what? That we should be what? Holy and without blame. Before him in what? Love. Love relationship. God loved you before the world ever was created. Before he ever created anything, he loved you. And he wanted you to be holy and blameless and in love with him. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace. How is this all accomplished? Through the grace of Almighty God. Hallelujah for amazing grace today. Amen? Because if it were not for God's grace, we would not be here today. By which, through his grace, he made us accepted in the beloved. Who is the beloved? It is Jesus. Capital B, the beloved. We are accepted only in and through Jesus Christ, the beloved. My friends, God wants to have fellowship with us. And the only way that fellowship could become a reality was if harmony could be achieved between the two natures of God and man. What a decision when God decreed that he would share his nature with his creatures. In the creation story, it says, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Genesis 1. So, my friends, what does it mean to be in harmony with God? What does it mean? Well, the basis of the God-man, God-Adam relationship was a shared nature. You see, this was the guarantee of the perfect companionship that God desired. And as long as Adam and Eve shared the same nature, there would be no conflict or stress between them. Hallelujah. I say, let's return to those days, right? Amen. They would be in perfect agreement. They would think in the same way. They would share the same values. They would be in perfect harmony. They would love each other with a perfect love. They would be mutually committed to faithfulness to one another. To do anything to displease or hurt the other would be unthinkable. Isn't that what you want in any love relationship? That you would do nothing to hurt the other person, ever? You see, my friends, it's the similarity of their natures that would go beyond the factor that binds the two natures together. They would enjoy a satisfying relationship. They would share the same interests and pursue the same goals. It would truly be wonderful for both God and man. See, God wants that as much as we do. God wants that kind of relationship with us. And so it worked for a time in the Garden of Eden. Can you imagine that? A lot of times I sit around thinking, I can only imagine what the Garden of Eden would have looked like. Can you imagine Jesus coming down, walking with you every day in the garden? Can you imagine face to face walking with Jesus? I think of that a lot of times. That's what he wants now. He wants that to be restored. That fellowship, that harmony was beautiful. There was no tension. It was exactly the way God had envisioned it. But the problem was that this wonderful relationship was conditioned on one thing: obedience. Obedience. Obedience to God's command on the part of Adam and Eve. And when they exercised their power of choice in an act of disobedience, everything changed. It all fell apart. That beautiful harmony, that love relationship, that one-on-one companionship, that same nature, what happened? It dissolved. It dissolved. It broke down. The innocence, the purity in which they were created, it was lost. Man no longer could share in God's holiness. He became a sinner, and as a sinner, conflict arose between God and man, and sin and holiness are not compatible. And as a result, man became an enemy instead of a friend of God. No longer was there harmony between them. So, the question then became, was there any way for that original harmony to be restored? Because let me tell you, God is always about restoration. God always wants restoration. It would not be easy to restore that which was lost. God had to uphold the integrity of his government and apply the penalty for sin. And that was this: disobedience of man did matter. It did matter. It was a serious problem. It mattered a lot. And something had to be done. So what happened? What happened? They were cast out of the garden. The angel with the flaming sword protected the garden's entrance. They could no longer get back into that one-on-one relationship. They were expelled. There was a consequence. My friends, God had to do that because sin and holiness are not compatible. We were expelled from God's presence. What a day. What a dark day. What a dark day. But God had to be faithful to his nature. He had to do that. The only way the relationship could be restored for man to recover what he had lost, how could it happen? Well, man certainly couldn't achieve it on his own. To make it happen, God had to take the initiative because man was incapable of approaching God. He couldn't get back to the garden. He couldn't get back in. Man could not do it. You couldn't get back in the garden. No matter how hard you tried, no matter all the good stuff you did, no matter all the laws you kept, you couldn't get back in the garden. The only way was one way. The only way was one way. The door was opened. For spiritual renewal was when Jesus died on the cross. Jesus dying on the cross was now given the possibility to restore the original relationship to which God had destined the human race. It means the creation of a new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Paul repeats himself in chapter 2 of Ephesians. It is the restoration of what was lost and the return of a relationship of harmony with God. My friends, we had paradise, we lost it. Jesus died and we regained it. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? But it's interesting to note that the other dimension of being back in a right relationship and harmony with God is that individuals are now turned to holiness in God. They are also brought into harmony with each other. You see, their harmony with God means that they can become compatible with each other. They share the same values, goals, and objectives. This is the fulfillment of the prayer of Jesus for his disciples in John 17, verse 21, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I in you. Because, see, as God shares his nature with his people, they are bound together in harmony and unity. Believers enjoy harmony with God and with each other. And wherever this harmony does not exist, the ideal of God's plan has not yet been reached. If there is disharmony in the church, God's plan is not being done there. Let me tell you this, it is this harmony between believers that will be the most convincing argument to the world that we are believers, that we believe in Jesus Christ, and that Jesus is real. Jesus said, by this will all men know that you are my disciples if you what? Love one another. You know what the church tends to do? What does the church tend to do? Fight, argue, dislike each other. What does that tell the world? That Jesus isn't real. Jesus isn't real. But if we love each other, if we're in harmony with each other, same goals, same values, same plans, same objectives, then it tells the world what? We've been with Jesus. We love each other. We love each other, right? We've got to do a better job, church, of letting the world know that Jesus is who he says he is. Because you see, God loves the sinner. Aren't you glad God loves the sinner? But I can tell you this, God hates sin. God hates sin. You know what the church has been saying for now, maybe a couple decades now? God loves a sinner and he doesn't care what sin you do. That's what the church is saying. The church is saying you can keep on sinning and do whatever you want because you know what? You're actually offending God if you ask God for repentance of your sins. What? That's what they're teaching. Let me tell you, that's what they're teaching. They're saying, Jesus down the cross, you don't need to repent of your sins. You don't need to turn from your sins because he loves you. Let me tell you, he loves you, but let me tell you, he hates sin. He hates sin, and you better repent of it. Repent of it, and when you repent of it, my friends, then you're brought back in relationship with him. Because I can tell you this, the result of sin is separation from God. Sin destroys the purpose of God in creation. Sin is in opposition to God. And let me tell you, opposition to God is never a good idea. Never a good idea. Can you imagine shaking your puny little human fist at God and saying, you know, God, I don't like you. Well, that's what you're saying when you're sinning. When you're sinning, you're saying, I don't like you, God. I can do it my way. I have a better way. I'm smarter than you. I don't want to be holy. You can just leave me alone and let me do my own thing. I don't need you anymore. My friends, that's what you're doing every time you sin. Every time you sin, you just shake your puny little fist. That's what you're saying to God. Now, you kind of, what? We would never know how. That's what sin does, my friends. It's insanity, I know. But to be in harmony with God and to enjoy fellowship with Him is the greatest of all blessings. My friends, to those that lose that harmony, it's the greatest of all losses. But thank God there is a way. Thank God, my friends, for the grace of God today. Thank God for His amazing grace that calls us back. Because you see, my friends, God loved you long before you ever loved Him. And God called you long before you ever heard His voice. And He wants a relationship with you. Praise team, would you come? He is beckoning you today. He is beckoning you. He's calling to you. He's wooing you. He wants to be in a relationship with you. He wants to have harmony in that relationship. He wants you to know that holiness that He experiences with you. He wants you to know the love that He has for you. If you do not know the love of God today, and if you do not know the forgiveness of God today, if you are still in rebellion against God today, I want to encourage you, please come and ask Him for forgiveness. Repent of your sins. Acknowledge your need of Him. Call upon Him today, for today is the day of salvation. And start walking in harmony with Him. In other words, tune your instrument to His. Right? And walk in harmony. Let's stand together. Amazing grace today. If you don't, I just want to encourage you to come today, because there's going to be coming a day you're going to see Him face to face, and it may not be the encounter that you want, but if you are His, it will be something so glorious and wonderful.
Through disappointment and danger too, through labors and sorrows we've come, but God's grace has guided safely through, and it will surely lead us home. And it's all because of God's amazing grace. Because on Calvary's mountain He took my place. And some tears, some glory.
saying, if you need to come, come now.
And with the ransomed and round God's throne, we'll praise our Redeemer and King. We'll tell how His mercy for sin did atone through countless ages. Song we'll sing.
Tried to do the last couple of weeks is simply this. I've tried to speak to you very plainly, very simply, about the way of salvation. I hope that all of you are leaving here having a better understanding of what it means to be a Christian, what it means to walk in the way of holiness, what it means to live the Christian life. I just want to encourage you, if you still do not understand, if you do not know, I want you to come and talk to me, talk to Joel, talk to Jim, talk to one of us, and let us know that you need better understanding, okay? Because I do not want any of you to ever leave here saying, I don't understand what salvation means. I don't know what it means to be in a relationship with Jesus Christ. I just want to encourage you, if you've not done so, please do so before it's eternally too late. Father, I want to thank you for our time together today, and I pray a special blessing upon my people. I pray that they may come to the full understanding of the knowledge of God in Jesus Christ. They may walk in holiness that is pleasing to you, that they may live lives of righteousness before the world and before each other, that we may be in harmony with you and with the brethren here in this church, that the world may see and know that Jesus is in us, and they will want what we have. For it's in your name we pray, amen and amen. God bless you. Love you guys.